Okay, is this on? I guess it is. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Martin Fackler. I'm a journalist and researcher at the Japan Rebuild Japan Initiative Foundation, which is a Tokyo-based think tank. And I am also the moderator for this session, which is entitled When Growth Falters. And we'll be looking at the economic dimensions of this question of whether or not we're in some sort of a new normal. But before we begin, I just want to briefly express my appreciation to the Asan Institute and to all you folks who've made this possible. Asan really does put on a wonderful show. And I've been to probably a half dozen Asan conferences, and they really are great, and this is no exception. So I really do want to say thank you to Ham Chebong and to his crew for once again pulling off an exceptionally good meeting. So, when growth falters, the idea behind this panel is that 2008, with Lehman Shock and the global financial crisis, that's now 8 years have now passed, and we don't really see growth returning to pre-crisis levels, and that we see a lower growth, and perhaps a new reality of a lower growth. Europe appears to be mired in the Greek debt crisis and similar issues. China has had a slowdown. Japan, Abenomics has not delivered all that it's promised. And even in developing economies, double-digit growth seems to be an artifact of the past. And so are we in a new normal of low growth? And particularly here in East Asia, which has been an engine of growth in the global economy, are we in a new era or a new normal? And so before we begin to explore that, let me first describe how we're going to do this. I'm going to ask the question to each of the panelists, are we in a new normal? And ask them to answer for 7 minutes, and you can go a bit longer, as long as 10, but I'm going to try to keep it capped at 10 just because I want to have enough time for discussion. Then we'll go into some sort of, hopefully, a discussion here on stage, and I'll get the audience involved as well. And let me just quickly introduce our four panelists before we begin. We have a really great lineup today. On my immediate left is Stephen Cargman, who is the president of Cargman Associates, which is an international strategic advisory firm, which I think deals in developing countries and debt issues and things like this. Stephen was previously the lead attorney with the Export-Import Bank of the United States. To his left is Idu Huan, who is an economist at Yonsei University, and you were the associate dean at the Graduate School of Economics at Yonsei, as well as many other positions. You've also worked at UC San Diego and Columbia University. To his left is TJ Pimpel, who is a professor of political science at UC Berkeley. Also an appointee on the Japan-U.S. Friendship Commission, and has worked at Cornell, University of Washington, and a number of other top American institutions. Last but not least is Zhang Jun, who is a professor, or dean of the School of Economics at Fudan University, and is one of the leading Chinese thinkers in economics and has written extensively on economics. So without any further ado, if I could ask the question, are we in a new normal? And maybe ask each of the panelists to go one at a time. And then if you have something to comment on each other or respond, please raise your hand at the end. I'll also have some questions, then we can open up to the floor. Thank you. Stephen?
Can I start?
Yes, please start.
Okay. Thank you, Martin. I'm going to talk specifically about the emerging economies and what the new normal means for those economies. With global economic growth slowing around the world, the global economy is now facing challenges that just a few years ago, when global liquidity was abundant, when commodity prices were soaring, when emerging economies in particular were experiencing rapid growth, and when the Chinese economic juggernaut, which was helping fuel global growth, seemed virtually unstoppable, when those challenges would have seemed hard to imagine. Yet today, many of the world's major emerging economies, including virtually all of the BRICS, especially Brazil, Russia, China, and South Africa, not yet India, but India, there's a lot of talk that they're not achieving their full potential, even though growth is supposed to come in at about 7.5%. So the BRICS and other major emerging economies, such as Nigeria, for example, have experienced slower growth and in some cases even sharp downturns. Emerging economies with strong commodities exporting orientations and emerging economies heavily dependent on exports to China have been particularly hard hit. A lot of this relates to the situation with oil. With oil prices having reached record lows in recent months, oil producing countries across the board, from Venezuela to Nigeria to Russia to the Gulf countries to Azerbaijan, among others, have seen their growth rates cut sharply. But it's not just been limited to commodity-producing countries focused on oil. It's extended to a broad range of other commodities, such as metals and other minerals. Many of these non-oil commodity-producing countries have also seen their economies severely challenged, whether that's in Latin America, Sub-Saharan Africa, or elsewhere. The old normal saw Sub-Saharan Africa growing at very fast rates, and now that has changed dramatically across the continent. With commodity prices plummeting and with China's demand for certain types of imports decreasing sharply, the net result is that many emerging economies and developing economies are now facing major financial and economic strains. This will be reflected perhaps in the not-too-distant future in some of these countries having sovereign debt problems. We're already seeing some of the sub-Saharan African countries approach the IMF, and so we may see more of that in the next few years. There will be lots of corporate distress in these economies, and infrastructure projects may also face serious challenges. To be sure, political uncertainty and corruption scandals in certain major emerging economies have only compounded the challenges facing these economies. Exhibit A on that point is Brazil, of course. Brazil has really been hit with a perfect storm between the sharp drop in commodity prices, since Brazil is such a big commodity producer, whether it's oil or iron ore or other commodities, sharp drop in commodity prices, the political situation in Brazil where there's been paralysis for the last number of months surrounding the president, President Dilma, which culminated last Sunday, I think it was, in the impeachment vote against her. Now it goes to the upper house. And to make matters even worse, they've had a third level of complication, which is the so-called Petrobras scandal. Petrobras, as many of you probably know, is the big state-owned oil company. And in the last 2 years, roughly, there's emerged a huge corruption scandal centered around Petrobras, where basically Petrobras was receiving kickbacks from the contractors. And these are big contracts that Petrobras hands out. And the excess funding was being used to support the political party, the PT, the Workers' Party. And so this has mushroomed into a huge political scandal, corruption scandal in Brazil. And it's already led to some key arrests, convictions. For example, the head of the biggest construction company in Brazil, Odebrecht, has been caught up in the scandal, but there are a whole range of other companies. And this is another downward pressure on the Brazilian economy, because Petrobras now can't let out contracts the way it did. So that affects all of the contractors and suppliers to Petrobras. I know we're not supposed to be all gloom and doom, as we heard in the morning session. So some people see some sort of silver lining in this, though, that Brazil, like many emerging economies, has been marked. Its economy has had lots of corruption over, and political system, lots of corruption over the years. But with this Petrobras situation, they call it the car wash investigation, Lava Jato in the Portuguese. They've had a very vigorous set of prosecutors going after political officials, private individuals, corporate officials, and so some observers see this as a very positive sign that the Brazilian system is working to the extent that there are thorough and aggressive investigations underway that will get to the bottom of this corruption, and that the hope is that Brazil may come out stronger. But in the meantime, the new normal for Brazil, for example, is very shaky, especially with this political situation. And as many of you may have seen in the newspapers, some of the political figures that might become more prominent if Dilma steps down, there have been reports that they're under different types of investigation. So there was some thought that maybe the vice president would be a better manager of the Brazilian economy, but he has a cloud of suspicion above him and some of the key legislators. So Brazil is just one example, a big example, the biggest economy in Latin America, that's facing serious problems, but other emerging economies are facing similar difficulties. I was in Nigeria 2 months ago. They are so dependent on the oil exports, and so they've been hit very hard. I was in India just last week, and as I said at the outset, India is the fastest growing of these economies currently, but there's still a lot of disappointment in India with the economic performance, because many Indians think India should be growing at a much faster rate if they had better infrastructure, if they had more transparent governance, that it could achieve much higher rates of growth. So that's a quick overview of the state of the emerging economies.
Thank you, Steve. That was great. Professor E, would you like to go next again? Seven to 10 minutes, please.
Sure. Well, as an economist, let me define the, what do we mean by new normal. Economically speaking, we call it secular stagnation. In more detail, it's a coexistence of three lows: low growth rate, low interest rate, and low inflation. And these three lows are maintained in the long term, longer, much longer than we expected. And this is something that we have never experienced before. So is Korea in the new normal? My general answer so far is not yet, not yet. If you look at the other OECD countries, these three lows were maintained after 2008, and it was extremely low that they actually had almost zero growth rate, almost zero interest rate, and almost zero inflation rate, some in some cases minus inflation rate. And that has not been materialized yet in Korea. Actually, if you just look at the macroeconomic indices of Korea, it's much better than the other OECD average, probably one of the best after 2008. However, even though it's not fully materialized yet in Korea, I don't really think this is extremely optimistic news, because we have a reason for this mild phenomena in Korea. First of all, Korea had relatively mild impact of global recession after 2008, probably because Korea maintained those asset prices and the potential of the bubble before the crisis. And also, Korea recovered relatively fast and solidly compared to the other OECD countries. And due to these two factors, so far, the new normal phenomena has not been fully materialized yet in Korea. However, we have a danger. If you look at the other OECD countries, especially Japan, Japan has been experiencing the new normal for almost 20 years after the collapse of the asset bubble in 1991, especially after their failed attempt to raise the consumption tax in 1995. From the middle of the 1990s all the way to today, Japan actually experienced these three zeros, almost for 20 years. So it's not new at all to Japan. And the biggest concern in Korea right now is whether we will follow the example of Japan. And there are some concerns, because if you look at the macroeconomic and also microeconomic aspect of the Korean economy today and compare it to Japan in the middle of 1990s, we do have many resemblances. Asset prices were declining, including the real estate price and the stock market price, not as rapidly as Japan experienced, but definitely it's in the declining phenomena. We do have issues in terms of the corporate restructuring, and there are many more of outflow of investment than inflow of investment to Korea. So when you combine all these factors, the biggest concern is whether we will have a new normal or not, following the example of Japan. And in order to answer this, I think we need to look at some negative aspect and the positive, some positive aspect as well. And how we will handle these negative aspect in the near future, and also how we can maximize the positive aspect or take advantage of those positive aspects will eventually determine whether we will follow the Japan example or not. So let me first list some of those negative aspects. After all, we had a gloom prospect this morning, so let me emphasize the negative aspect first and try to lay some positive silver lining in the last few minutes. In each aspect, I will try to classify internal factors and outer factors, external factors. Externally, everybody knows that we have a slowdown economy in China and rest of the world. This is a particularly bad news to Korea, because more than 40% of Korean GDP depends on export. And the currency war, the so-called currency war, especially in the neighboring countries of Korea, is a great concern. Even though we had some rebound of the Japanese yen, we do not know how long it's going to last. Generally speaking, for the last 3 or 4 years, currencies were depreciating nearby in the neighboring countries. And of course, we do have some uncertainty about the U.S. interest rate policy. So these three aspects are kinds of negative aspects, externally speaking. However, the thing is, we do not have any control over these external factors. We might be able to neutralize the currency war by depreciating our own currency, but there is a limitation as well. So I think more than anything else, the internal aspect is more important in terms of these negative factors. Internally, rapidly aging society is a great concern. It's, of course, a big concern politically and socially, but economically, especially in relationship with this new normal, this is a big concern, because rapidly aging demography actually reinforces the negative aspect of the new normal. As we have more and more old people, our growth potential is deteriorating, and more old people, they do not consume, they just depends on their pensions and savings, so consumption is weakened. And as we have more and more saving, the interest rate cannot go up. And, of course, as we have more saving, we do have the so-called saving paradox, which actually dampens our growth potential again. Consumption is a big concern in Korea. Korea's consumption ratio out of GDP is one of the lowest in OECD countries, and probably among all the other developing countries too. Consumption today is accounting for only about 50% of Korean GDP. And without increasing the consumption rate out of GDP, it will be very difficult for Korea to maintain growth that depends on domestic demand. And we do have a structural problem. The high household debt, which is hovering around 160% of the national disposable income, make it very difficult for Korean households to increase consumption. We do have some room to invest. That's a good sign. But the problem is Korean companies are bipolarized. Large companies, they have pretty good capability to invest, but they do not. They do not invest because of regulations in Korea, because of the uncertainties in politics circle, because of the high labor cost and bad labor relations. And a lot of small and medium-sized companies, they cannot invest because of their financial situation. So let me use my final 1 or 2 minutes to lay some light on Korean economy. Well, even though I talked about the slowdown of the Chinese economy as a negative factor, we also have some positive side from China as well. Generally speaking, Chinese growth rate has been slowed down. But if you look at the number, especially increase of consumption, you may elaborate on this. Consumption is increasing relatively fast. And contribution of consumption to the Chinese GDP was almost 2/3 in the recent data. So we actually have very different pictures among Korean companies who are dealing to, who are having businesses inside Korea. Some companies are having a hard time, but I just came back from Beijing 2 days ago, and I have visited a couple of Korean companies engaging in service and consumption, domestic consumption sector. They are doing very good. They had 30% or 40% annual growth of revenues for the last three or four years, and they expect that it's going to continue. So we do have bright side out of the Chinese economy as well. Even though consumption is slow in Korea, we also have seen some recovery of consumption in recent data. That's another good sign. I told you that the yen had been depreciating for the 3 or 4 years, but starting from this year, it's going to be appreciated, and we wonder how long it's going to continue. Inside Korea, domestically speaking, I think we can find some positive aspect as well. At last, inside the political circle, I think we do have some consensus on the need to restructure the Korean corporate sector. And I'm not quite sure whether the new party, the new result of this National Assembly election will produce a more positive outcome, but at least there are consensus among the politicians. And compared to the other OECD countries, our fiscal position and our monetary position have some room to maneuver. We do still have relatively sound fiscal position, and our interest rate, our policy interest rate is still 1.5%, which is actually one of the highest among OECD countries. We still have room to lower it. And there are some signs that new engine of growth are emerging among some startup companies and among some sectors of the economy. So if only we can take advantage of this some positive aspect, I think we still have chance not to follow Japan.
Great. Thank you, Professor Lee. TJ, are we in a new normal?
New normal, as you described it, was focused primarily on economics. It was a global slowdown. It was a rise in unemployment. You didn't mention directly the rise in inequality. Professor Lee talked about the three negatives or the three lows. And certainly from the economic standpoint, I think this is the new normal until politics intervenes to reshape the economic picture. So the heart of my message is that there are political solutions to this that need to be explored. But I think it's also important, as we think about the new normal under these economic circumstances, to recognize that a big spin-off from the economic downturn have been dreadful political consequences, particularly in terms of things like the rising unemployment, the rise in inequality, the rise in populism, particularly quasi-fascist, neo-right-wing, et cetera, et cetera, problems with this. And I think there's even an embedding, particularly within the Western European context, of the roots that have supported Islamic fundamentalism, Islamic terrorism. So I think the political consequences of this economic new normal are both going to be the new normal, as I said, until politics intervenes. That said, I do have a couple of positive things to suggest on this. The first thing I would suggest is that we've often been in these situations where the economy looks like the perfect setting for portrayals of gloom and doom. I'm old enough now to remember the oil shock of the early 1970s and the sense that deflation and stagflation were going to be the new normal, and we escaped from that. We had the problems of the Asian financial crisis in 97-98, from which Asia very quickly escaped. We had the whole problem of the dot-com bubble and burst in the United States, and again, the American economy recovered, I think, quite successfully. So I do want to suggest that if this is a new normal, it's not necessarily going to be an inflection point that leads to a several decades period of economic demise and political turmoil. So that would be my first point. The second point that I think is important to keep in mind is that it becomes very easy to fetishize economic growth. It's easy to fascinate ourselves with the notion that a rise in GDP is a plus and a decline in GDP or a slowdown in GDP is automatically a minus. But I think we have to recognize the fact that particularly within the industrial world, there are an awful lot of very, very successful countries where an awful lot of people are quite happy, whether we're talking about Canada or Sweden or the Netherlands, where growth rates are not particularly astounding, but where there is a reasonably broad level of satisfaction among the general public, where there is a measure of industrial creativity, where there are reasonably high levels of employment, reasonably secure safety nets, and people tend to live a reasonably happy life. So, for example, I think it is getting to the point of ridiculousness where we have become so fascinated with the rise in the PPP slash GDP of China that we're now talking in these apoplectic terms about the possibility for a Thucydides trap in which the rising great power, i.e. China, will be in a position to challenge the declining great power, the United States. And it's tended to be predicated primarily on the fact that China is growing so quickly in its GDP. I think 90% of the world, if given a choice about where they would want to live, might very well opt for Western Europe or the United States or Canada as opposed to going to China, particularly if you have to breathe in Beijing. So I do think that there are problems that are associated with this notion of fetishizing the growth per se. The politics, though, I think has been stymieing and very difficult to overcome, and certainly from my perspective as an American, I think we've gone overboard in assuming that something called a free market is going to magically solve these problems of the new normal, that if we just allow prices to deteriorate, everything will somehow take care of itself. I think that was the logic in the 1929-32 crisis or numerous other crises, and I think that that's a belief in fairies and Tinkerbell that that I don't happen to share as a reasonably adult individual. I think that's also been a real problem to try to address the causes of that Lehman shock, the Lehman financial crisis, particularly within the United States, particularly within the British banking system, that would require some serious addressing of the ways in which a sensible balance has to be struck between giving markets freedom to allow creativity and initiative and to reward creativity and risk, while at the same time making clear that we are avoiding the worst excesses of casino capitalism by providing positive roles for government to provide regulations, checks, safety nets and guardrails to prevent the kind of freewheeling derivative trading or housing market explosion that took place in the United States and nearly brought the global economy to a crunching halt. The underlying difficulty, I think, politically, is the fact that political systems, generally speaking, adapt very slowly. There is a phenomenon called institutional stickiness. There are powers that be that do not want to see their positions eroded, and yet one of the great awarenesses that we have about capitalism is that it's continually a process of creative destruction. And somehow or other, it becomes necessary for the buggy whip manufacturer to give way to the auto manufacturer or the taxi driver to give way to Uber. And this is a process that is very painful, but it's one, and it's one that's very resisted for political reasons, but that is endemic to long-term creativity and escaping from that new normal. And as a last pitch for the socialism that perhaps you know, we heard about this morning as the solution that might come from the United States, I think it's important in that creative destruction process to acknowledge the fact that those who lose under a globalization or who lose under adjustments to market forces should not simply be thrown to the bottom of the scrap heap and assumed to be down at the bottom of the food chain, but it's necessary for governments to step in and provide job retraining, relocation allocations, safety net, et cetera. Countries that have done this have been very successful in moving people out of no longer relevant jobs into much more relevant jobs, moving them out of areas where there are industrial pockets of rust and moving them into places where there's creativity. I could speak at great length about a couple of different examples of this. We heard about the Japanese case. My sense as somebody who looks at Japan quite frequently is that a great deal of Japan's problems have been the political reluctance to slay some sacred cows, whether we're talking about the agricultural cooperatives, whether we're talking about protected small and medium-sized businesses, whether we're talking about the Sonys, et cetera. But Japan, along with many other countries, needs to do more to incentivize young people, the creative people who are going to move into the market and perhaps come up with the next new mousetrap or the next Facebook or the next Twitter, et cetera. But I think the same is true of the case of Brazil, an awful lot of political resistance to the economic changes that are needed. President Putin has not done a very good job of transforming the Russian economy. It's still very, very dependent on a declining oil market. He's done a great deal, perhaps, for nationalism. And in an example that was just pointed out to me recently, Saudi Arabia, the political message coming out of Saudi Arabia is, yes, we're indeed now learning to diversify our economy, to getting away from oil. What's the new area that they're moving into? It's petrochemicals. This is not a country that is on the verge of a political adaptation. So the broad message, as I said, is this will be the new economic normal until we get political reactions that begin to challenge the forces that now lead us to that economic difficulty. Thanks.
Thank you. Professor Jung, do you want to speak?
All right. Let me begin by talking a little bit about the Chinese definition of economic new normal. I think tons of the conferences every year in China about discussing about new normal. So I learned a lot more about what is the new normal. Initially, I saw this is definitely a stepping down of the Chinese growth from the hyper growth period to the long term, moderate growth, which I think is inevitable. If you look at what happened in Korea, 20 years ago, Korea was a miracle, terms of the hyper growth. But now, it's moving down to something like the quite modest, if it's lowers the growth in the Korea history. But so I think China just began to moving down from that period of time where, huge investment has been driven the growth, since the early 1990s. But now, a lot of structural change is taking place in the Chinese economy, and there is a dramatic drop of the
fertility rate in urban areas. You know, migration has been slowing down. You know, from rural to urban. You know, the labor costs have been rising very rapidly over the past decade or so. So I think that all, you know, given other things being equal, I think that all of the structural factors that have changed over time, over the past decade, are going to really, you know, created some of, you know, downside, downturn for the Chinese economy. So I think the new normal naturally would be quite a natural, you know, phenomenon, which by most of the economists would like to say this is quite kind of, you know, convergence, you know, of, phenomena. So it's not something new. But I think, you know, in the context of the Chinese case right now, the new normal means, you know, the government really wanted to let people know, you know, this is something, you know, happened globally, and that we perhaps should have some of the programs that to make the economy more, you know, domestic, demand-driven, rather than being heavily, you know, relying on the external, you know, export. And also, you know, it's been a lot more discussion about this, you know, transitioning of the growth model, you know, which I think China has been following over the past two decades, which is, I mentioned, you know, this investment-driven or manufacturing-based growth. On this, the new growth model, which is really based on the domestic demand, the consumption, or something like that. But it's difficult, you know, to really make that transition happening. So I think that when there is a global slowing down and trade stagnation, I think that, you know, there is a kind of leverage that the government perhaps can utilize, you know, to create some of the consensus within the leadership that, you know, this is no way that China can escape from this new normal. So we, you know, the only thing that perhaps they really want to do is restructuring the economy, you know, and creating more demand from the service, from the consumption or something like that. Don't want to mention this. I think this is true that the service sector right now has been a leading sector in China, you know, committing a much more contribution to the growth of the Chinese economy. And I recently put on the article in the Project Syndicate talking a little bit about the Chinese unemployment rate, you know, because people saw the employment rate in the urban areas must be rising, you know, given the growth of GDP has been slowing down. But if we use the very micro data, which is based on the household survey for the cities, and we found that over the past several years, with the unemployment rate in urban areas, you know, were keep quite steady, and actually is moving down a little bit, simply because I think that the service sector created more jobs and it's taking more, you know, laborers from the downstream of the, you know, manufacturers, and actually the service sector created a much faster job than the manufacturers over the past 10 years, you know, 4 percentage points higher than that of employment growth in the manufacturers. So, so this is, you know, a kind of, I think the concept that you know, not only the government, but most of the business guys would like to, you know, accept that, you know, this is just the new normal. You know, we kind of follow the, you know, the conventional way of the making the growth happen. You know, so they need actually to think about what is the new sources of growth, not only from the business sector, but also from the policy makers. You know, because you know, you can't really rely simply on the huge investment into the real estate sector, infrastructure, and something like that. And so that's also part of the reason why the government is quite, you know, strongly proposing the, you know, of, encouragement of the new business sectors by giving more, you know, stimulus to the entrepreneurship. Thank you.
Professor Yi, did you have something you wanted to say?
I just had a couple of comments on the point raised by Professor Pempek. It is true that rising inequality has a great political implication everywhere in the world, and that's also true in Korea. But if you look at the measurement of inequality in Korea, which is usually Gini, actually it is improving from 2012. And a lot of people wondered how come we have an improvement of the relative inequality of income distribution. But once you look at the data more closely, you can understand the top 10% high income earners, their income was not growing at all, almost no growth in real term from 2012. When the bottom 10% income was growing in real term thanks to more and more welfare spending by the government. So as a result, we have an improvement of the income inequality, but that's not exactly a good sign because there was no growth in the high income sector, which is actually a reflection of growth, loss of the growth potential in Korea. The more important problem in Korea than inequality is poverty. Poverty issue is different from inequality issue. When inequality was actually improving, poverty showed no sign of improvement. So I think Korean politicians should pay more attention on tackling poverty than on improving inequality.
Thank you.
Because this is very much to do with the economic growth. Because growth matters for poverty reduction rather than for, you know, improving the inequality, right? Sure. But what about the wealth, the distribution of wealth in Korea?
The wealth distribution, we don't have annual data of wealth. It has to be estimated. But when wealth distribution gets worse, it's usually because of increase of asset prices,
right,
especially the real estate price. But everybody knows that asset price in Korea was not increasing at all for the last probably 10 or 15 years. So my rough guess is that wealth distribution did not worsen either.
Just a quick footnote on that, though. I mean, it is useful to contrast perhaps the South Korean case with that of a lot of other countries. But in the United States, we've seen a huge growth in the income inequality, which the top 1%, the top 0.01%, getting a huge chunk of whatever growth has been taking place in the U.S. But equally important, I think, to this whole question of the Gini index or inequality is the fact that we've moved to a situation in which an awful lot of what were once middle-class jobs are now moving into a situation of part-time work. It becomes very difficult for individual families to get by on one income. In some cases, we're talking about two jobs, et cetera, et cetera. So it was that aspect that I was really trying to underscore, and I'm perfectly prepared to acknowledge that there are cases in which Gini index per se or inequality per se may very well mask a lot of very deep problems.
That's right.
I just wanted to point out that in many of the emerging economies, the rapid growth prior to the current period helped move millions of people out of poverty and into the middle class. And the real question now is, will they slip back without that growth? So the governments will have to find a way to keep the economies growing so that they can keep those individuals. It was really record numbers moving into the middle class around the world. And so that was a positive of the last phase of growth.
Can I ask a question? Because this inequality is important because this the Piketty argument that inequality is actually a drag on growth. It actually harms the economy, right? And it sounds like everyone here agrees that there is a new normal. And I wonder if we could talk about maybe some briefly on the causes. Like how did this come about? One of the things I heard Steve, Mr. Yi, and Mr. Zhang, you mentioned was the Chinese slowdown. And it almost made it sound like if China hadn't happened, that this new normal would have happened years ago. and it's Chinese growth that maybe was keeping us out of this new normal, and maybe all of us except Japan. Could you talk a bit about what, if there is a new normal, what's going on? How is this happening?
Me?
You want to start? Anybody?
Okay. Well, you know, I think the China had experienced the hypergrowth since the year 2002 and 2003. And then the growth rate peaked in the year 2007, which the growth of GDP was something like 14% in real terms. You know, so this is really high. So the economy cannot sustain that point, and they're going to definitely going to turn it, you know, down after, you know, the peaking in the year 2007. When growth accelerated over that period of time, I think that you can see there is a huge investment went to the infrastructure and the real estate sector, which is largely financed by banking loan, right? So you can see that the credit to GDP ratio had, you know, began to rise very rapidly, you know, over that period of time, you know. So even there is no financial crisis the year after, I think the, you know, Chinese economy would definitely going to move in downturn because, you know, it needed adjustment they needed actually address the high leverage problem, you know. So this is what still the government is doing right now because when the global financial crisis occurred, where the government, changed the policy overnight, because you definitely should put the macro tightening policies, given the economy was huge, heated at that time. But when the global financial crisis occurred, where they actually turned the direction, you know, they actually turned the tightening policy to, you know, the easing policy, you know, so they give a lot more, credit, put into the economy to try to sustain the growth, which perhaps is, you know, 2-digit growth at a special period of time. But it's definitely not sustainable, you know. So 2 years later, after the stimulus package was implemented, where the economy cannot move, you know, because the huge, creation of a debt, you know, for both government and corporate sector. So then the government decided to put another, tightening policy to slow down the growth. So this is actually still in the period of time where everything going to be in tightening rather than being losing control right now. So I think where even the policy going to change right now from now on, you know, from the tightening to easing, I think Chinese economy cannot really grow faster than perhaps the, you know, 7% or 7.5%. Even you still want to put a credit, you know, into the economy to fuel the investment demand or something like that. Simply because I think that in the long term, the growth potential of the Chinese economy has been moving down, given the, you know, almost zero growth of the labor forces, you know, and also the rising labor costs to the corporate sector. So you know, factors like the demographic transitioning and something like that, I think are going to really slow down the potential rate of growth.
Oh, thank you, TJ. Yeah. Do you want to comment?
Yeah, I guess you talked about, you know, what caused the new normal, and I think, you know, there are at least two ways to think about this. At least I can think of two. One is just sort of the global macroeconomic situation in which, for example, China's, you know, extensive growth really did fuel a huge amount of global demand, which obviously kept the wheels of the global economy moving forward very well. And, you know, I'm usually inclined to suggest that this had some negative consequences, because basically I see it as an oversaving China and an underconsuming industrial world. And so China facilitated some of the worst practices in the industrial world by being so generous in its trade policies and so forth. That said, I think there's a whole second tier that we can't lose sight of, and that is the Lehman shocks or the global meltdown in 2008-09. I don't think that had China slowed down 3 years earlier, that somehow the Lehman shock would have taken place in 2005. I think this is very U.S. domestic, with a lot of links to Western Europe, but you know, it had to do with the introduction of a whole series of incredibly complicated financial products. It had to do with a lot of avoidance of risk management. It had to do with the use of the housing market as a way to diffuse the political problem by making it easier for people to get into houses, which was very much supported by a savings and loan industry that was more or less completely unregulated, savings, loans, and non-financial companies, but making it possible for, I mean, I'm very much a fan of Michael Lewis's book, The Big Short, but you know something's wrong when, you know, a pole dancer in Las Vegas owns seven condos and is able to, you know, roll over these mortgages year after year, even though, you know, her annual income is, short of the interest she's getting on these apartments, is $25,000 or $30,000. So I think there are some very specific U.S. crises that link to the financial markets globally. So there's more than one cause of whichever crisis you want to focus on. Steve?
From the perspective of the emerging economies, the growth in China made it easy for the emerging economies because they could just look to their commodities to power their economies, and they didn't have to really come up with a well-thought-out economic strategy. TJ used the phrase diversification before. They didn't really have to think about diversification because if China needs their coal or their aluminum or whatever commodity China is, oil, it's there, and they can ship it. And there's growing demand, and the prices are very high. And so it was really an easy default position for them. But the problem is with the new normal for these economies, the emerging economies, when the tide goes out on economic growth, you see all the begin to see all the problems that have been there all along. The infrastructure is very deficient in many of these countries. There aren't basic things like good roads, good highways, airports, ports, and that's not even to mention the social infrastructure, the schools, the education, healthcare. So those problems have been there, and some of them were addressed a little bit with the rising incomes in these countries, but still major problems persist. And Professor Zhang mentioned the growing credit. Well, this is an issue throughout these economies. China has the so-called NPL problem, the non-performing loans. But that's true throughout many of the emerging economies. They have huge stocks of non-performing loans. And basically what that does is it ties up the capital of the banks to make new loans. So that will be a drag on the economy going forward unless these economies address non-performing loans. And another problem, it's not just unique to China, are the SOEs, state-owned enterprises. And in many of the emerging economies, there are state-owned enterprises that the back to the issue of political will, the governments don't want to rationalize the state-owned enterprises, the SOEs, even if they're unprofitable, inefficient, or suffer from overcapacity, because they provide employment for a lot of people, even if it's not productive employment per se. So the governments have been reluctant to deal with that issue. So basically, the commodities boom and the China boom provided an easy way out for a lot of the emerging economies not to face some of the more fundamental challenges that they've had all along.
What about developed economies? I mean, were there fundamental challenges that developed economies that, I mean, it's almost as if we've hit a inflection point in terms of the system. I mean, are the ways that economies run just that, is that method or that thinking is just becoming outdated and the reality is caught up with us? Because it's more than just the developing economies, right? It's Europe, it's the U.S., and maybe elsewhere. I just wonder, I mean, what deeper down, is there something going on here?
As I told you, one of the biggest concerns in Korea today is how not to follow the bad example of the other OECD countries. But when you look at the other more advanced OECD countries, basically monetary policy and fiscal policy, the traditional policies of the government, simply do not work. It worked not as good as before, and in many cases, you simply do not have any room to expand monetary policy and fiscal policy when you have zero interest rate and when a lot of OECD countries are running huge budget deficits. That can be a serious challenge, or limitations, I should say, which was fundamentally different from the past. In the past, it worked. And because of these problems, still, we do have a great deal of imbalance inside the economy, basically accumulation of debt. Some country has accumulation of debt in the government sector. Some country has debt in the private sector. But whatever sector it may be, huge accumulation of debt is still there, which was kind of non-existent before 2008 crisis. And that, I think, is a new phenomenon that even the advanced countries have to face.
Right.
I'll take off my emerging economy hat for one moment,
okay.
But really some of the economies I'm going to talk about have behaved like emerging economies. I'm going to talk about the Eurozone for a minute. I think the slow growth throughout Europe and the Eurozone in particular has grown out of this failure to address head-on the sovereign debt issue in the periphery countries, the Greeces of the world. If you pick up the paper in recent days, it's still the same story in Greece. Greece negotiating with the Eurogroup creditors and haggling over the conditions for further disbursements. We're 6-7 years into this process, and the problem still hasn't been resolved, and I think that's been a drag. You're all more expert than I am in this area, but I think that's been a drag on the growth throughout the whole Eurozone. The failure to resolve some of the sovereign debt issues, that raises a more fundamental problem. How do you deal with sovereign debt crises? But we can discuss that another time.
Just to piggyback on that and maybe take it in a slightly different direction, it seems to me much of Western Europe, certainly the United States, has found it politically desirable, but I think economically disastrous, to concentrate on not expanding their budgetary situation, not moving monies into creating jobs, creating employment in the United States, building infrastructure, but instead have essentially been trying to tighten down. And it seems to me this is too much similar to 1929, 1932, the kind of nationalist protectionist mindset that resists the logic of Keynes. Now, I don't want to get into the arguments about economics on this, but it does seem to me this is a real problem in the United States. That, you know, it's fallen to the federal banks to try to resolve the problem, primarily because we've got no capacity for political action in the United States to begin addressing some of these fiscal problems. I think much the same is true in some parts of Europe. I think it's been very tough for the Brits to do it. I'm sympathetic to the notion of Greece with sovereign debt, but the little bit I've been reading about it doesn't suggest that the Greek politicians have been very anxious to crack down on tax evaders. You know, the Panama Papers suggest that there are an awful lot of rich folks out there that are somehow getting a free ride on their taxes, and they could play a big part in resolving some of those sovereign debt issues.
We've also had this idea that Japan is kind of a pioneer of the new normal, right?
Yes, right.
And that it hit the new normal 20 years ago and has responded to it or not responded to it in various ways. Are there lessons or can we tease something out of Japan's 20-25-year experience with the new normal to give us some insight into where the rest of us now stand today or what we can do next? Professor Yi, do you want to go first?
Sure. Actually, this is not exactly my study. It's a study by some of my friends in Japan. And I got some, I asked them to give us some recommendations. I'm pretty sure the professor Fukagawa Yukiko is doing the same thing in the other room right now. They actually gave us a couple of lessons. First, their government policy, especially the military policy, was not timely. So timely implication, timely
implementation
of the military policy was fairly important, which Japan failed. And second, they also delayed corporate sector restructuring until almost 2000, almost 10 years after the collapse of the bubble. So timely restructuring of the corporate sector to get rid of the zombie companies and to let the money to channel into more fresh ones. And of course, all those reforms in the labor markets and the regulation reforms, these kinds of things were delayed and postponed until all the way down to after 2000s. I think that those were lessons that we tried to draw.
Yeah. A couple of things to add on this. I mean, I think a lot of this is certainly correct, but and you know, take it back to the macro level, I think it's been a political resistance to changing the old structures. But there are a couple of other points that I would want to add to this. I was very impressed by the fact when MJ Jung was being introduced that he was mentioned to have created a foundation in Korea that would encourage young entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. One of the things that I find fascinating about Japan is, you know, the young entrepreneur in Japan is the 57-year-old who at retirement goes out and, you know, starts his own independent taxi company. I mean, you know, I'm somebody who, even though I don't understand it, is fascinated by all of the stuff that my students can do technologically and the ways in which that spill into information technology, social media, the creation of all of those new companies in Silicon Valley or in the Boston area or in Austin or in Minnesota or whatever, just strike me as one of the great strengths in the United States. And I certainly don't want to come here as a preacher about American virtues because there are a lot of drawbacks. But Japan does not have anything remotely like that. And in fact, one of the real downsides of Japan's slow growth has been the fact that companies have basically tried to protect the jobs of the 45-year-olds or the 50-year-olds, fair enough, but that means they're not hiring the 25-year-old or the 22-year-old out of college on a permanent basis, let alone giving that individual the opportunity to go out and, you know, get in a garage and create. So at some point, I really want to look at the Korean case of young people moving into the workforce and the extent to which that does provide a dynamism that keeps the Korean economy going in ways that I fear is not present in Japan. On the other hand, just one quick positive note. I've been bashing the Japanese economy for 25 years. It is useful to recognize the fact, two facts. One, with a declining population, which Japan has, it does mean that their GDP per capita is going up not badly. So, you know, there are lots of folks who are left out of this, but for the most part, that's a plus. And secondly, you know, I drive down the streets of Berkeley, and I need to get my wheels realigned every 6 months. I mean, it looks like it's a testing zone for IEDs. I mean, Libya could be the place for these roads. You go to Japan, the roads work, the cars work, the trains work. Everything's on time. It's organized. The kids get reasonably decent educations. It's a place whose infrastructure is not that bad. Crime rates are virtually non-existent, et cetera. So there are a lot of problems there, but let's not, you know, consign it to the graveyard yet.
Steve?
On the Japan lessons question, I would echo a lot of what Professor Lee said, that Japan postponed dealing with its problem loans and the zombie corporations for a long period of time. But then finally, Japan took some aggressive action through a government-created agency, semi-autonomous. It was called the IRCJ, Industrial Revitalization Corporation of Japan. And they had to make the tough decisions as to which companies were worth saving and which needed to be liquidated because they were really zombie companies. But so they finally started to attack that problem. As Professor Lee was saying, it took a long time to get to that point. But and so what they did was actually the Japanese government realized they did not have the talent within their bureaucracy to deal with these commercial type issues. So they brought in a lot of outside experts in business turnaround and restructuring to help them carry out these processes. So I think in the end, they did some positive things. I just wanted to follow up on something TJ has been saying about entrepreneurship and creative economy. I've heard the former Minister of Commerce and Trade from Indonesia speak, and she said one of her, she's former, Mary Pengestu, and she makes a very compelling case that Indonesia should be emphasizing this creative economy, that they have lots of people who are very skilled in artistic endeavors, and that the government should be trying to encourage that. Now, of course, it'll take some time, and it may not produce as many jobs as some other businesses, but these governments do need to think about branching out.
You want to? I want to say one thing, though. With Japan, you mentioned the streets. You go to Tokyo, you don't know there is a recession, right?
That's right.
Or a downturn, right? And so this brings us to the question of, is growth even what we need to be focusing on, right? Or maybe as part of the new normal, maybe a focus away from growth into some other measure of prosperity or quality of life. And TJ, you mentioned the fetishization of growth. You know, is part of the new normal maybe that we can't grow like we used to grow, or that we don't need to grow like we used to grow?
Yeah, I guess I did use that word fetishization of GDP growth, but and I guess I sort of have a schizophrenic answer to that. I mean, in the sense that I think lots of countries can do very well with slower growth, and that it's a mistake just to focus on last year was 3% and this year is 3.2%, so somehow that's better. And I think it is important to focus on things like quality of life and to appreciate the fact that you know, there are lots of countries that are capable of providing interesting and intriguing jobs and providing good lives for their citizens, but I think they also, in the best of cases, are places that do reward ingenuity, that do have a capacity to reach out for the next exciting new thing. I mean, one of the difficulties with Japan, in my view, is that there's still that lock into Galapagos tech. I mean, it's astonishing that Sharp was just being taken over by Foxconn now. And that seems like the ultimate insult to Japanese technology. But, you know, this Japanese technology in the 80s was at the cutting edge of the world, and it doesn't look like it's moved very far beyond that, except that, you know, Japanese have much better phones than the rest of us, but they don't work anyplace else, so why bother?
So they all use iPhone now, right?
Yeah, exactly. Well, the phone system in Japan, I mean, this is, you know, there are no globally competitive Japanese smartphone companies.
It's interesting that Sony was a post-war startup, Honda was a post-war startup, Kyocera was a post-war startup. I mean, a lot of what you're seeing in the 80s was a result of a flourishing of entrepreneurship
right. In
the post-war. Professor E, you had something you wanted to say.
Yes, I agree that growth, economic growth, and GDP are not the only criteria that can measure the living standard. However, comparing Korea to Japan and think that Korea can enjoy the relatively good living standard, just like Japan did for the last 20 years, even though they did not have any growth, is a dangerous idea. I give you a couple of reasons. Japanese long stagnation started in the early 1990s, when the real GDP per capita was already around $40,000, mm-hmm. according to 2005 price. Okay. Korea's real GDP per capita today is only about $25,000. Yeah. So if we begin long stagnation, just like Japan did 20 years ago, we will have to suffer a lot more disease, social disease and economic disease, than Japan is. Just, I'll just give you just one example. When Japan get into this long slowdown, they had old people, and almost 100% of these old people got pension, which was way higher than the pension Korean old people received. And if you look at Korea today, only about 40% of the old people, Korean old people, receive pension. And for those Korean old people who receive pension, their pension is only about one quarter or one third of the Japanese old people's pension. Mm-hmm. So if we get into long slowdown from now on, we simply cannot improve this kind of situation. Second, in the early 1990s, Japan get into slowdown without debt. Government didn't have debt. Japanese private sector did not have debt. They had some debt in the zombie companies, but they eventually took care of it. Now, Korea has serious debt problem in the household sector. Mm-hmm. As I told earlier, 160% of disposable income. We have reached this level several years ago, and it does not improve at all. So with this huge amount of debt, if we get into no growth from now on, it will just aggravate. It will not be able to improve.
Yes, Professor Zhang, a quick question to follow up, then I'll get open to the audience.
I think this is one of the lessons that perhaps emerging economy can learn from Japan. It's about rebalancing the structure of the economy at the macro level, because we learned that Japan failed to develop the service sector, opposed to the manufacturers, because there's a lot more, regulation and control of the domestic service sector. Financial sector is not that liberalized in advance. So there is a quite obvious the inefficiency in both of the financial sector as well as the service sector. So when external shock occurs, so usually such high-performing economies cannot respond. So there's been a dramatic drop of the growth. So I think China now is facing this similar problem, because we need actually learn that from Japan and created the policies to support the expansion of the domestic services, so that we probably can accommodating the external shock. Let me give one point about the GDP and its correlation with the Human Development Index, which definitely statistically has been quite positive, correlated. I think speaking of Korea, which I think Dr. Lee mentioned, is only about for 60% of per capita GDP of the U.S. Right now, the Korea has
about two-thirds. Yes.
Yeah, something like that. And Japan maybe 70%, and perhaps a little bit higher than 70%. But China, according to the PPP version of the estimate, it's about 25%, something like that. So that means you still have very limited coverage of most of the people by pension. You have retreating from the poverty, so perhaps in the rural areas, and saving rate is quite high, but consumption is relatively in a slow growth. So there's a lot of things which is quite, I think, related to the happiness of most of the people. Still need to be developing as a result of economic growth.
Thank you. Well, I hope we've chummed the waters enough to get some good questions. Can I get one, two, three? Let's start with three, and then we'll have folks answer, and then we'll go back to the floor again. Okay, you want to start with this gentleman here, gentleman down there, and then the gentleman here.
Okay, great. Thank you very much.
Please introduce yourself
yes,
and
absolutely.
Keep it to a question.
Yeah. Vladimir Shopov is my name from Bulgaria. I have two questions. One has to do with the three zeros that you talked about. And I'm a political scientist, not an economist, so, you know, forgive some of the ignorance. So there seems to be this idea that somehow when the next crisis comes around, we're suddenly going to be out of instruments with which to manage a future crisis. And my question is, to what extent you actually agree with this position? And if you do not, what would the toolkit for response in the next crisis look like? And just a very brief question. A lot of people have been saying the last couple of years that one of the ways in which to stimulate growth again is through signing, trade agreements, and indeed, you know, there have been a lot of these in the pipeline, some signed, et cetera, et cetera. The TTP was signed, the one between the European Union and the U.S. is now being negotiated. What are your views on that one? Thank you.
Thank you. Gentleman down here at the end.
I'm a student in the ASEAN Academy, and I have a question to Professor Lee. It was about, as a student learning in Korea, I'm very skeptical about the economy of Korea because of aging society, need for restructuring of corporate structure, and only seeing the monetary policies that the Bank of Korea is taking, we can see it's not affected by the domestic economy, but rather for foreign economies. So my question is, our generation has the greatest burden. It's the first generation that the income is declining from the elder generation. So what could be a solution for us that could we see a brighter future in an economic perspective? Thank you.
Thank you. Well, welcome to the new normal. And then the gentleman here, you had your hand up.
Thank you very much, Earl. I'm a former finance minister and then currently chair professor of Korea National Diplomacy Academy. First of all, let me congratulate all the excellent speakers and participants. Let me make a 3 point. So this is not a question, but
I
hear it in my voice. The first one is, we usually think that we used to overestimate the short-term issues. In other words, in the two or 3 years, we are too much worried about. But we are usually underestimate the long-term issues. So that means, I think more important is the long-term issues. In other words, how to improve productivities. This is not in Korea. This is all over the world, even in the United States. But my point is that real concern is that it's not to slow down the economy, but the real concern is that we run short of the weapons. We do not have enough policies, but we do not have appropriate policies, which we used to do. But the most concern is that politics, in other words, policy is one thing, but implementation is another. So now you might hear that some kind of a sophisticated state failure. Not in the States. Nothing happened, right? So that means how you incorporate politics in the policy implementations. One more thing is that politics is internal issues, but problems politics deals with are international. So typical one is a so-called globalization. All the U.S. presidential candidates are, in my view, anti-free trade, even Mrs. Clinton, right? So, how you deal with the globalization, in the future? I'm not sure.
Thank you.
And then one more thing is that as far as a distribution process, I think grows.
Mm-hmm.
I think now, the year of average is over. You have to consider distribution when you set up the policies. But technically speaking, now we can do. I like to ask your attention to so-called big data. In other words, there's some kind of big changes. Maybe somebody say that statistics may be gone away.
Why not? Why not? We collect all the data, right?
Oh, thank you.
So that means, I think that in that sense, I think we, in some sense, I mean, this is, I'm not sure if this is normal, new normal or new abnormal, mm-hmm. but we have to focus the new setting of the policies rather mm-hmm. than the phenomena itself.
Okay.
That's my comment.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Those are good points. I think your point also goes to the first question of being out of instruments. And if I can add to that, this idea that can nation states even respond to the issues we're talking about? Do the confines of sovereignty limit us too much to deal with these global forces? Does anybody want to take that instruments question or policies, or do we have the toolkit question? Do you want to take a shot at it, Steve?
Well, from the developing economy, emerging economy perspective, I think they know what the tools that are needed are. They just don't implement the policies that they really know they need. I think part of it is the inertia generally in government, but also there are problems of corruption and lack of rule of law that prevent things from getting done. And so I think one of the real tragedies, if you will, is that many of these countries, they have terrific young people, incredibly talented, world class. I lecture to them in Washington, the high level civil servants who come in, but they can't accomplish what they would like to in their systems because the systems are very difficult for various reasons. So if they could overcome some of these structural bottlenecks and let some of these more talented entrepreneurial people, whether the public or private sector, get things moving, I think that's really the issue, as opposed to specific policies per se. I think they all know they need better infrastructure, they need to take action to clean up their banking systems and so forth, but it's hard to get things done in their systems. So some way's got to be found to break that jam.
How about for developed economies? How about this idea of we're out of weapons or instruments? And our nation states, in a sense, failing, Dr. Yi.
Well, if we have a crisis again, I think we will have to rely once again on monetary policy, fiscal policy, and cooperation and coordination among large companies, large countries. But what is really more important than how to deal with the next crisis is how to prevent the next crisis. And here I will tell you the most important recommendation my Japanese friends told me. Do not create bubble at the first place. Be prudent. Try to be prudent in your macroeconomic policy so that you do not create bubbles and deaths in your private sector or in your government. That would be probably the most important lesson we have to learn, and then we forget almost every 2 or 3 decades.
Maybe part of the new normal is a casino capitalist. I mean, it seems like we have these cycles of boom and bust that are compressed, maybe. I mean, is it a function of technology or information? It seems like we're going in the opposite direction, in other words.
Well, actually, that's another aspect of the new normal. We usually had a cycle of some expansion and contraction, not exactly boom and bust. But that cycle has been lost for the last almost 10 years. Mm-hmm. When you have an extremely low growth, government used to stimulate the economy by pouring money or by spending more government expenditures, and then you trigger some growth, and then eventually, or because of those money released in the recovery process, you will have the threat of inflation. So there was a cycle of low growth, and then going back to high growth and inflation, and then low growth again. But this cycle has been lost after 2008.
TJ, I'll put you on the spot.
Yeah,
here.
Slightly different perspective on this, and I think it was implicit in one or two of the comments that were made, but that is, An awful lot of the problems that are being faced, whether it's economic or demographic, are in fact long-term. I mean, Japan knew it was going to have a demographic crisis 25 years ago, and suddenly people are waking up this morning and saying, my God, we're getting old. So, I mean, it's not as though the statistics are not there. And yet the problem is that political perspectives are very short-term, whether it's democratically elected individuals worried about the next election or whether it's dictators worried about the next possible coup. The fact is that the political eyesight is very myopic, and so you know I'm struck by the comments that were made this morning by John Hamre about the ways in which at the end of World War II political leaders were able to get together and make decisions about the creation of institutions that were going to be very beneficial for opening up trade, for providing for economic assistance to big parts of the world, that were going to be able to create institutions like the UN that would at least theoretically begin to approach global problems. And so I do think we have this situation where many of the problems that are being faced are in fact going to require multilateral or trans-border solutions, and it's very hard to get politicians to sign onto those because for most politicians, their constituencies are national or even subnational. So I think that's a fundamental problem. But just to pick up one quick thought on this free trade agreements business, on balance, and I have to defer to the economists on this, but the general rule of thumb is that most of these FTAs are at least economically positive in the long run, that you know this is a move toward the greater good for the greater number. But one of the difficulties, I think, is that all too often we fail to recognize that different sectors in different countries are going to be the major beneficiaries of these things, and conversely, there are going to be some dramatically negatively affected individuals or sectors, and that's where I think it becomes politically critical to begin either retraining people or providing for some sort of assistance to regions that are decimated. You know, Martin talked about Japan with, you know, if you're in Tokyo, it looks like there is no crisis. But if you go out to some of those rural areas, you know, there are seven old people that are trying to, take care of an entire city or a village at least. And so the rewards and punishments for economic growth are not evenly distributed across anything
Tokyo
called the country.
And Japan, that's true.
Yeah.
Can I answer?
Yeah, you want to talk about the diminished expectations for young people?
Well, I got the question from those two young Koreans. You said that you were skeptical about your generation's future, right? But many of those negative aspects that I emphasized, structural problems. Actually, we do have answers and policies that can handle those structural problems. We can deregulate the economy so that large companies can invest again inside Korea. We can change our economic structure from manufacturing-oriented economy to more service and consumption-oriented economy so that it creates more jobs. We can let the old and especially rich people spend more money so that we can boost up consumption. But all these policy recommendations are stuck in politics, as Mr. Hyun just told us. Many of these good policies were there. We simply could not carry it out because it was blocked by the National Assembly because of some political deadlock between ruling party and the opposition party. And probably that's the area that we have to reform first, our politics.
Okay, I think we've come to the end here. Do you want to have everyone maybe give a final, say, a minute and a half wrap up, and maybe some final thoughts or anything that you didn't get a chance to say? And should I go in reverse order? Do you want to start, Mr. Zhang?
Well, that reminded me of the point made by Douglas North. He said the government actually the causes of both economic failure and economic success. Because we need to back to the fundamental of economics, which is the productivity is the ultimate determinant of economic growth. I think there is a lot of way that the government can enhance the productivity growth and also can actually
destroy that. So I think this is lead to another this round of discussion about politics and economics.
Thank you.
I think I'll pass.
You'll pass?
Korea is not in new normal yet, but we have a danger of following the Japanese example. To avoid it, I really hope that we can find some solutions inside our political circle so that good policies could be effectively implemented to give more hope to our young generation.
Can I ask TJ a question then end with? Will Abenomics end the new normal in Japan?
We'll go back to Japan again.
I mean, this is going to be the ultimate in cliches. Three arrows. He shot the first one. The second one isn't being done very well, and the third one seems not to be even out of the quiver. So, I mean, if Japan makes the structural reforms, and if Abe proves to have the kind of commitment to economic reform that he's shown toward reintroducing a nationalist agenda, Japan could very well turn things around. But I think this has been a very slow process, and I think, you know, some of the things that he's been doing for women and employment have been extremely slow, extremely thinly based. I mean, you know, they're the same thing with young people. I mean, I don't think his heart is in economics, and I don't think that's where he's going to really want to be making his mark. And so I'm not convinced. I mean, I think the plan for Abenomics is correct. I just don't think he's the guy that is going to carry it out.
10 seconds. What's the third arrow that you'd like to see?
Structural reform.
But a bit more specific.
I would like to see substantial labor market reforms, for example, and I'd like to see some variant of that that would get more women into positions of serious employment, whether it's full-time or some version of family plus, you know, decent employment. And also, I'd love to see some kind of change in the geriatric mindset that that makes it very difficult for any company to restructure itself when the 90-year-old chairman is still, you know, upstairs coming in 4 days a week and holding back the 60-year-old current CEO.
Steve?
As I've said this afternoon, I think the real challenge for the emerging economies is addressing some of the fundamental problems that they've had for quite a while, but that the commodity boom, among other things, masked. And so go back to the basics. Hard infrastructure, which if you visit these countries, you know what I'm talking about. The roads are much worse than I think existed, even Berkeley, and the airports and the railways. I'm leaving China out of this. But apart from the hard infrastructure, they really also have to focus on the soft infrastructure, their human capital.
Right.
And that's education, that's training, that's legal systems that work, rule of law. So I think they should use this period of slowdown to try to address some of these more structural, fundamental issues that could put them on a more sustainable footing going forward so that they wouldn't be subject to the vagaries of the commodity cycle.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you so much for your time and for joining us, and thank you so much for coming along as well and for the ride. It's been an interesting 90 minutes, and thank you for doing this. And let's give our panel a round of applause.